God, you are my God, eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a barren and dry land where there is no water. So all of the spiritual masters of all religions tell us the same thing. All creation thirsts for God. And yet we are also told, be careful which well we drink from. I was delighted this morning, between the two services, some of the youth or kids were out there wanting to get wet in the forest. And some of the adults were saying, no, stop, we'll do that. And I went over and I sat down and I reached in and I got my hand wet and I said, here's where you were baptized. Feel the water. Remember your baptism. You have a beautiful place where you can drink from the well. Not literally. But I would encourage you not to stop them from touching the water, because they know in their young selves they are drawn to the waters of baptism. Touch the water yourself, remind yourself of your baptism. We are told, be careful of which well you draw from, because in our thirst, we can drink from the wrong well. Moses is out tending the sheep, and he sees a bush that is burning and not consumed, and he's intrigued, and he goes to see what's going on, and forever then his life has changed. God takes him from leading sheep to pasture to leading his people into freedom. And Moses says, tell me your name. Who are you? When the people say, who is this? What name do I give? And God says, I am who I am. I will be who I will be. Do not put me in a box. Do not try to define me, limit me, tie me up nice and neat, and say, well, that's what God is. I can put you on a shelf. For ever since, God is defined only by God's self. And so when Moses brings the law, one of the important laws is no graven images. Because the image we have shapes our understanding of the divine. And if we take and make images out of wood and clay and stone, we make infinite that. We make finite that which is infinite. And we are commanded, do not do that. No graven images. As followers of Jesus, we also know there is an image of God we can turn to. We know, we believe, that God's not simply distant, out there, unmoved. God is here, present with us, among us, and in us. Because we believe that God came in the person of Jesus, and when we look at the image of Jesus, we see God. We look at Jesus, and we see love. We see compassion, and mercy, and healing, and justice. We look at Jesus, and we see the God that crosses borders and boundaries, the God that goes out and calls people beloved. God knows us each by name and calls us beloved. And God says, you are beloved, and nothing you do will change that. So we look at Jesus, and we see the image of God who is love, and we see the love that we seek. Now there's a saying, if you don't care where you're going, it doesn't matter what road you take. It's not a bad saying for if you decide to do a fun summer road trip. But it's a dangerous saying if you are seeking God. Well, God, you are my God, eagerly I seek. Because while there might be, in fact, many roads to God, what we seek will help determine what we find. And there are gods we can seek that are not the God of Jesus, or the gods of wealth, the gods of fame and privilege, the gods of war and division, the gods of fear and hatred. There's also simply the God of comfort, one that looks like me and says, you can spend an hour in worship and go home and do nothing different. That's okay. We can seek those gods and we'll find them. Or we can seek the God who is I am. We can seek the one who brings liberation from slavery. We can seek the God who is incarnate and shows us what love really looks like. We can seek the God who is the Spirit that dwells within us at all times and teaches us we are never separate from God. We can seek the triune God who we worship this morning. Now, Paul is talking to a community gathered, and it's a new community following Jesus, and they're not yet sure what it means to be followers of Christ. They don't know quite yet what it means to be together following Jesus. And Paul says to them this morning, basically, keep the moral ground. Stay on the moral high ground. Stay in the straight and narrow. And he does this by going back in the salvation history and telling them a story. And the challenge, the trap of today's lesson from Paul is that we can fall into the trap of saying, if you are bad, you sin, bad things will happen to you. And if you're good, you'll be blessed. And that trap is seen throughout Scripture. That trap is seen throughout theology down the ages. And that trap is the God of karma. And that trap is one we easily fall into because it actually makes some sense to us and it lets us off the hook. See, it helps us say, I can make a moral decision about you simply by your life circumstance. If you are doing well, you must be a good person. And if your life is hard, you sin. If you're healthy, you're a good moral person. If you're sick, you sin. And Jesus is not the first, and he's not the last, to say God does not work that way. Do you think those Galileans whose blood Pilate mingled with their sacrifice are worse sinners? No! No, I told them. And the 18 killed by the tower? No! Jesus is telling us that life is not about simple cause and effect, reward and punishment, God karma. Now, he's not necessarily as comforting as I would like him to be, because he seems to be saying things like this. Tragedy happens, death comes sudden, now I'm going to live. Unless you repent, you'll perish as they did. And it's easy to hear that repentance says, confess your sins. Because we often think that. Repent, confess your sins. But repentance is so much richer than that. Repentance is about seeing a different path and going down that other path. Repentance is about turning to the God of love, turning to the God of life, turning to the God who brings liberation and freedom from slavery. Repentance is about following Jesus. So perhaps when he says, unless you repent, you'll perish as they did, maybe what he's saying is, turn from your thoughts that it's about cause and effect, but it's about simple good and bad. Turn from the idea that you can blame the victim. And because when you do that, you're actually blaming God. Oh God, you are my God, even the next. So Jesus then goes on to tell the parable of the fig tree. And it's a fig tree, it's not bearing bad fruit. It's not being bad. It's bearing no fruit. Nothing at all. And the owner comes and says, cut it down. And the gardener. And just in case we forget who built the first garden, who's the first gardener? The gardener says, give me time. See, Jesus is telling us a parable about the God of mercy, the God who works with us and gives us what we need to bear good fruit. And sometimes, it's about seeing possibilities where others see none. God sees the goodness in us when we don't see it in ourselves. God sees the goodness in others when we don't see it in them. God sees the possibility that exists for every one of us. And God helps provide what we need so we can bear much good fruit. Now, Linda was telling me a story about when she first came, she looked out on your garden area where the orchard is, and she thought, oh, come down. Now, can you imagine where you would be today if she got away? Where would the garden be? Where would the apples be? Seeing possibilities where others don't see it. It's one of the things that God invites us into. Oh God, you are my God, eagerly I seek you. What God do we seek? What God do we follow? It makes a difference. We hear this morning, seek the God who is I am, the God who brings freedom from slavery. Seek the God who is incarnate and shows us the face of love. Seek the God who is the Spirit who dwells within and will never, ever leave you. O God, you are mine. Eagerly I seek you. Drink deeply from the well of eternal life. For God is already there with you. And when you seek God, you'll find God.